السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. نحمده ونصلي على رسوله الكريم. أما بعد، فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي ربنا زدنا علما. Page number 89. So we were studying about the AhlusSunnah wal Jama'ah as to why they are given the title of AhlusSunnah wal Jama'ah. In the previous line we learn, وَلِهَذَا سُمُّوا أَهْلَ الْكِتَابِ وَالسُنَّةِ. And this is the reason why they are called the people of the book, meaning people of the Qur'an and people of the Sunnah. Why? What's the reason? Because they? Give me the answer from the text. Exactly. Because they believe that the Qur'an is the truest speech. It is Allah's speech. And the guidance of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the best guidance. And because they prefer the words of Allah, the words of the Messenger, over everyone else's words, they give preference to the Qur'an and Sunnah. The Qur'an and Sunnah are final authority for them. This is the reason why they are called people of the Qur'an and people of the Sunnah. But they are also called people of Jama'ah. So, وَسُمُّوا أَهْلَ الْجَمَاعَةِ. They are called the people of Jama'ah. Why? لِأَنَّ الْجَمَاعَةَ. Because Jama'ah, what is it? What does it mean? Here it is al-ijtima'. It is gathering. Ijtima'. What does it mean? To gather together. A gathering of people. And it's also when people are united. They are together in one place, on the same page. This is ijtima'. So this is the reason why they're called people of Jama'ah. وَضِدُّهَا, and its opposite, whose opposite of ijtima'ah, is al-furqa. It is furqa. What is furqa? Division, separation. وَإِن كَانَ, even though, لَفْظُ الْجَمَاعَةِ, the word Jama'ah, قَدْ صَارَ, it has come to be used, isman, as a term, لِنَفْسِ الْقَوْمِ الْمُجْتَمِعِينَ, for a people that have congregated. Meaning the word Jama'ah has two usages. One is ijtima'. It means unity, gathering. And the word Jama'ah is also used as a qawm that is mujtami'een. A qawm, a people that have come together. Like for example, when people are praying together, what is that called? Jama'ah. Right? But the word Jama'ah doesn't just mean being together in one place. Performing something, you know, together, all at the same time. Jama'ah also means ijtima'ah, to gather together. It's the opposite of division. What does Jama'ah mean? Unity. So who are AhlusSunnah wal Jama'ah? The people who are upon the Sunnah, the Qur'an and Sunnah, and the people who are together. People who are not divided. People who are united. And how is it that they remain united? By holding on to the Qur'an and Sunnah. Because remember that the further people are from the Qur'an and Sunnah, the more they will follow their own desires. And people's desires, they vary. There are as many as the number of people. And hence there will be division. So people of Jama'ah, meaning people of unity. وَالْإِجْمَاعُ, and إِجْمَاعُ. هُوَ, it is, الْأَصْلُ الثَّالِثُ, the third source, the third foundation. الَّذِي, which, يُعْتَمَدُ عَلَيْهِ, it is depended upon. What does اِعْتَمَدَ mean? اِعْتِمَاد, to depend upon. So ijma' is the third source that is depended upon فِي الْعِلْمِ وَالدِّينِ, when it comes to knowledge and when it comes to religion. Meaning the AhlusSunnah have three foundations. They have three foundations on which they base their ilm, on which they take their knowledge from, and they base their deen, they base their religion upon. The evidences, the proofs that they take for their knowledge and for their deen, where do they get them from? Three principles. And what are they? The Qur'an, the Sunnah, and thirdly, ijma'. So what does this show? That ijma' is a proof. That when the scholars have unanimously agreed upon something, that is also a proof. That is also something that we have to abide by. Alright? وَهُمْ يَزِنُونَ, and they weigh. يَزِنُونَ from wazan. What does wazan mean? Weight. So their way, meaning the AhlusSunnah way, بِهَذِهِ الْأُصُولِ الثَّلَاثَةِ, with these three foundations. جَمِيعَ, all of, مَا, that which, عَلَيْهِ, upon it, النَّاسُ, people are. And what are people upon? What do the people do? مِنْ أَقْوَالٍ, of statements, وَأَعْمَالٍ, and actions. Meaning people say many different things, and they also do many different things. And these statements and actions of people, they are some which are باطنة, internal, أو ظاهرة, and others are external. مِمَّا لَهُ تَعَلُّقٌ بِالدِّينِ, and they have some connection with the deen. Now, what happens is that people say different things. People do different things, right? Some of their actions, some of their statements are manifest, and others are hidden. Now, how do we know what people are saying is right? How do we know what people are doing is right? What is the criteria that the AhlusSunnah have against which they weigh the actions and the statements of people to see if they are right or wrong? So what is it? وَهُمْ يَزِنُونَ بِهَذِهِ الْأُصُولِ الثَّلَاثَةِ, these three principles. They check what the people are saying, what the people are doing. Does it conform with the Qur'an? Does it conform with the Sunnah? Does it conform with the Ijma'? If it does, it is haqq. And if it does not, then it is batil. It will not be adopted. Because you see, over time, are there innovations? Yes. Are there new ideas? Yes, because people are creative. They come up with new things, right? New slogans. So how do we know something is right or wrong? You check by what? The Qur'an, the Sunnah, the Ijma'. وَالْإِجْمَاعُ, and Ijma'. الَّذِي which يَنْضَبِطُ, it is ascertained. يَنْضَبِطُ is from ضَبْط. Alright? And الْإِجْمَاعُ الَّذِي يَنْضَبِطُ is the Ijma' which can be ascertained. Whose ضَبْط is mumkin. It is possible to ascertain it. Meaning it can be said with confidence that yes, all the scholars agreed about this. All the scholars unanimously agreed about this. Now if you think about it, any issue, any new issue, what do people say? So-and-so scholar says this, so-and-so scholar says that. Such-and-such imam said this, and such imam said that. So then you wonder, is there even anything such as an ijma'? Because you will always find varying opinions. Right? I mean, certain things which are clearly stated in the Qur'an and Sunnah, no difference of opinion. Right? But there are many other things concerning which we find difference of opinion. So, وَالْإِجْمَاعُ الَّذِي يَنْضَبِطُ, the ijma' that can actually be called ijma', about which it can be said that yes, all the scholars unanimously agreed about this issue. هُوَ, it is, مَا كَانَ عَلَيْهِ. مَا كَانَ, that was, عَلَيْهِ, upon it, as-Salafu as-Salih, the righteous predecessors. Meaning, the righteous predecessors, who are they? The first three generations. The generation of the Sahaba, the generation of the Tabi'een, and the generation of the Tabi' Tabi'een. The first three generations. What they unanimously agreed upon, yes, about that we can say, it is ijma'. It is something that the scholars unanimously agreed upon. However, after the first three generations, can we say that over this issue there is an ijma? No, we cannot say that. Why? Because إِذْ بَعْدَهُمْ, because after them, meaning after the first three generations, كَثُرَ الْإِخْتِلَافِ, the ikhtilaf, the differences, they increased. وَانْتَشَرَ فِي الْأُمَّةِ, and the ummah, it spread. So there are two reasons why ijma is only possible in the first three generations and after them, not possible. Why? Because first reason is, ikhtilaf increased. Differences became many. Why? Because people separated into groups. And with this division, I mean, everyone did not intend the truth. And this is a reason why people began preferring their desires over the Quran and Sunnah. And what happened? With so many differences, ijma became impossible. And the second reason is that the ummah spread out. How? The numbers increased. They weren't just limited to the Arabian Peninsula, but rather, over time, what happened? Muslims spread all over the world. And this is the reason why ijma' is something that has become an impossible matter. Is it something that we witness today? Yes. We want everybody to be on the same page. But it is not possible. Why? Because people think differently. Right? Living in different places, different circumstances, they have different priorities, and as a result, what they see to be the truth, you don't see it to be the truth. Correct? So what is the point of all of this discussion? What is being proven? That the AhlusSunnah, they have three foundations on which they base their actions, from where they take their knowledge. And what is that? The Qur'an, the Sunnah, and the Ijma'. Now when it comes to Ijma', some scholars are of the opinion that there is no Ijma'. Why? Because they say that there has never been a time when all the scholars agreed over something. So Shaykh Ul-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah is proving over here that no, Ijma' does exist. And when did it exist? Amongst the Salafus Salih. So in other words, the practice of the companions, the way of the companions, what is that? What is that? A hujjah for us. That is also something that we have to observe and give importance to. We can't say, oh, just take from the Quran, just take from the Sunnah, and leave the practice of the Sahaba. No, we also have to see what the Sahaba did. Because that is how the community, you know, it grew. That was the community that practiced the religion. Right? So we cannot neglect the way of the companions. So what are the three foundations? Anything you'd like to add over here? What do you understand? See, in the previous lesson I gave you an example. That something that the companions did, and they were not criticized by others. Like for example, Uthman radiallahu anhu, he started something, and he was not criticized. Right? Likewise, we see that Uthman radiallahu anhu, he extended the masjid of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, reconstructed it, made it more beautiful. And people criticized him, that why are you doing this? And he said that he heard from the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that whoever builds a house of Allah, Allah will give him a house in Jannah. So he wanted his house in Jannah to be beautiful, and that is the reason why he made the house of Allah in this dunya beautiful. So then what happened? People were okay with him. Alright? So the actions of the companions. Well, you have to see that what did the others say about it? Were their actions welcomed? Were their actions criticized? I gave you another example that Marwan, he reversed the order of Eid prayer and the khutbah. And you could say that he was a tabi'i. But was this change welcomed? No, it was criticized heavily. So that is something that cannot be called ijma. Alright? So basically the actions which the sahaba agreed upon, which the tabi'in agreed upon, behind which was solid evidence, that is also a hujjah for us. Alright? Next chapter, which is the last one. Fasl fi bayani mukammilati al-aqeedati. من مكارم الأخلاق ومحاسن الأعمال التي يتحلى بها أهل السنة في بيان the clarification of مكملات العقيدة the مكملات of عقيدة مكملات those actions, those matters that complete and perfect عقيدة and what are those actions that complete and perfect the عقيدة من مكارم الأخلاق of noble character, وَمَحَاسِنِ الْأَعْمَالِ and beautiful best deeds, الَّتِي which يَتَحَلَّى بِهَا adorn, they adorn themselves with. Who adorns themselves with these beautiful, noble characteristics and actions? AhlusSunnah. The AhlusSunnah. The AhlusSunnah adorn themselves with good character. They adorn themselves with good deeds. Because this is what completes aqeedah. Aqeedah is the root. It is a foundation. Where? In the heart. But remember that if there is a root, if there is a foundation, then definitely there will be fruits. There will be a structure that will stand upon that foundation. There will be a tree that will grow from that root. So, aqeedah is the foundation, it is the root, and the a'mal, the actions, and the akhlaq, the character, that is the fruit. And if the foundation is not good, then the fruit will also not be good. So the Ahlus Sunnah pay attention to the fruit also. That what kind of fruit are we producing? What kind of actions are we performing? What kind of behavior are we demonstrating? Because if our aqeedah will be correct, our behavior will be correct. And if there is a problem with our behavior, then what does that show? There is a problem with the aqeedah. Because the one who has right aqeedah, the one who truly believes in Allah, that Allah hears me, Allah sees me, and the one who believes in the akhirah, that I will be given my record of deeds, and this aqeedah is strong, it has a firm place in his heart, then will his actions change? Yes. Then can he speak uselessly? No. Then that person, can he treat his guest poorly? No. Can he have double standards? No. Did the Prophet ﷺ not say that the one who believes in Allah, then either he should speak well or be silent? The one who believes in Allah in the last day, he should treat his guest well. He should honor his guest. None of you can truly believe until he loves for his brother what he loves for himself. So our actions, remember, they represent our aqeedah. Our actions, they show what our beliefs are, what values we have. So the AhlusSunnah pay attention to these details also. ثُمَّ then, هُمْ they, meaning the AhlusSunnah, مَعَ هَذِهِ الْأُصُولِ, along with these principles, along with these foundations. Which foundations? Of adhering to the Qur'an, the Sunnah, the Ijma', and earlier what was mentioned concerning Aqeedah. What do? They يَأْمُرُونَ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ. They enjoin what is good. وَيَنْهَوْنَ عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ. And they prohibit evil. Because this is also part of Iman. Because from Hadith, what do we learn? A person who just watches evil happen. What kind of faith does he have? Very little. Because if we see something wrong being done, what should we do? Stop it. If we cannot stop it with our hand, then stop how? At least with our mouth. And if a person does not even do that, then what does it mean? His faith is very minimal. This is also part of Iman. What is considering bad to be bad and considering good to be good? What is bad? What is munkar? What the Sharia tells us that it is bad. And what is ma'roof? What is good? What the Sharia tells us that it is good. So the AhlusSunnah, along with these principles, meaning their aqeedah, they pay attention to that, their faith, they pay attention to that. But in addition to that, what else do? They enjoin good, they forbid evil. Because how is it possible that you love something, and yet you can see that people are opposing it? Or that you hate something, and you can stand and watch people doing it? Then that is not true love, that is not true hate. So يَأْمُرُونَ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَيَنْهَوْنَ عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ عَلَى مَا تُوجِبُهُ الشَّرِيعَةُ. According to what the Sharia تُوجِبُهُ, meaning the Sharia requires. Meaning they do أمر بالمعروف نهي عن المنكر in a way that the Sharia requires also. Meaning they don't just follow their desires when it comes to أمر بالمعروف نهي عن المنكر. They bear in mind the guidelines, the rules that the Sharia has given. Because remember, there are certain etiquette that has to be observed when doing أمر بالمعروف نهي عن المنكر. Like what? Like what? What are the guidelines that we have been given when enjoining good? Okay, idfa billati hiya ahsan, in a good way, so that amr bil ma'roof doesn't cause more evil, right? Or nahi al munkar doesn't cause more evil, right? So the manner should be good. A person should first know of what is munkar, what is ma'roof. He may be stopping people from something wrong. He thinks it's wrong, but it's not actually wrong. He's telling people to do something which he thinks is good, but it's not actually good. So with knowledge, in a good way, without bringing about more harm, and that he himself also abides by that ma'roof and keeps away from that munkar. وَيَرَوْنَ, and they see, meaning they consider, they believe, إِقَامَةَ الْحَجِّ. إِقَامَة, the establishment of, upholding, al-hajj, performing the hajj, wal-jihad, and jihad, wal-jum'ah, and the Friday prayers, wal-a'yad, and the Eid prayers, they consider that all of these must be performed with who? مَعَ الْأُمَرَاءِ, with the leaders, not individually. But how? With the leaders. Why? Because these acts of worship, how are they? Are they individual acts of worship? No. They are congregational, collective acts of worship. And when people are together, when there's a group of people, they must have an imam. They must have a leader to follow. Because when everyone is on their own, what does that cause? Chaos? And it causes differences, division, disunity? That creates more confusion? So the AhlusSunnah consider this necessary, that Hajj, Jihad, Friday prayers, A'iyah, they have to be done with the umara, with the leaders. What kind of leaders? Abraran kanu aw fujjaran. Whether those leaders are righteous or they are wicked. Why? In order to maintain unity. Who are fujjar? Plural of fajr. Someone who commits sins. Someone who is disobedient. Like for example, someone who drinks alcohol. He's a fajr. Someone who deals with interest, that's fujur. Abrar, who are abrar? Plural of bar. And who is he? Righteous. So, the AhlusSunnah, what do they believe in? Following the leader. Obedience to the leader. And leaving the actions of the leader to who? To himself. The Khawarij think that there is no obedience to a leader when he is disobedient. The Rawafid, they think that the Imam is an infallible leader. He's perfect. He's free from sin. And there is no Imam right now. There is no leader right now. Since the Imamat collapsed, they say, there is no leadership now. The AhlusSunnah say, there is Amir, there is Imam, and when there is an Imam, then accept him. Accept the leader. Why? Because if you don't accept the leader, then there will be chaos. And we see this rebellion against any kind of leader. What does that lead to? What does it lead to? Conflict. It leads to fighting. It leads to bloodshed. It leads to fasad, basically. So the AhlusSunnah believe that following the leader is necessary. But what if the leader is sinful? Even then. What if he's telling you to do something that clearly contradicts the Quran and Sunnah? Then no. Because there is no obedience to the creation in disobedience to the Creator. But if that leader is doing something wrong in his personal life, then you leave it to him. Alright? The Prophet ﷺ said, you will see preference, meaning biases, and matters that you object to after me. The Sahaba said, what do you order us, O Messenger of Allah? The Prophet ﷺ said, give the leaders their rights and ask Allah for your right. You do your part. And what is that? Give the leaders their rights. And what is the right of the leader? That he should be obeyed. That's the basic right of the leader, right? That he should be obeyed. So you obey the leader and ask Allah for your rights. Once a man asked the Prophet ﷺ, O Prophet of Allah, tell me, if the leaders start demanding their rights from us, while they are denying us our rights, what do you command us? What should we do? The Prophet ﷺ said, listen and obey, for whatever they do, it is only upon them, and whatever you do is upon you. If they don't give you your rights, and they demand their rights from you, then what is your responsibility? Listen and obey. Give them their haqq, because that is what you will be questioned about. And your huquq, what you deserve, you will not be asked if you fought for your rights. You will be asked about what you did, what responsibilities you fulfilled. Because your rights, who is supposed to give them to you? Others. Through whose idhn? Allah's idhn. So ask Allah for your rights and Allah will give them to you. Either through the leader or through someone else. So the AhlusSunnah believe in the importance of what? Following the leader. Because this is what keeps people together. And remember that leader cannot be followed unless and until he is accepted first. Accept that Allah has given certain people more authority. He has given them a position of leadership. He has given them certain power. And is this necessary? Is it necessary? It is. Because if it's not present in a group, then what will happen? Chaos, confusion, everybody's doing their own stuff. People are disconnected? Efforts are divided? So it is necessary that we accept this reality. Accept leaders. وَيُحَافِظُونَ عَلَى الْجَمَاعَاتِ And they guard, they preserve and upkeep the jama'at. What are jama'at? Plural of jama'ah, when people have gathered together. This is two things. First of all, congregational prayers. And secondly, it means agreement in matters. اجتماع على الرأي. Agreement in matters. Like the Prophet ﷺ said when he sent one of the companions to a group of people that make things easy and do not make things difficult. Give people good news and do not cause them to flee. Agree between yourselves and do not disagree. Agree between yourselves. Come together. Be united. Come on the same page. Even if you think differently. But once as a group you have decided something, then stick to it. And when making a decision, then how should a decision be made? Unanimously, together. All people who are concerned must be consulted, must be informed. And if that is not done, if the due procedure is not followed, then what will that lead to? What will that lead to? Friction. Again, differences, disunity. وَيَدِينُونَ And they believe it to be part of their religion. They consider this to be part of deen, meaning they worship Allah through this. Through what? بِالنَّصِيحَةِ لِلْأُمَّةِ النَّصِيحَة Sincere advice. For who? لِلْأُمَّةِ For the entire ummah, for the entire nation. What is nasiha? Well-wishing. Sincere counsel. Sincere advice. And what is the definition of sincere counsel, sincere advice, well-wishing? That what you like for yourself, you like for the other also. So they do this with who? With the entire ummah. And the entire ummah includes who? The leaders as well as the common folk. Everybody. They have nasiha for the entire ummah. And notice how yadinuna, they make this a part of deen. They consider this to be a part of religion. Now many times we give sincere advice to people. We want the best for them. Why? Okay, for our benefit, or for their benefit, or for the benefit of the group, right? Or for fear of punishment, for some good results. But what do we learn from this? What is the way of AhlusSunnah? If they have nasiha for the ummah, for what purpose? For the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. يَدِينُونَ They consider this to be an act of worship. They do this for the sake of Allah. They worship Allah through this. Through what? Having nusr for the ummah. وَيَعْتَقِدُونَ And they believe in ma'na qawlihi, the meaning of his statement. Whose statement? Of sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Of the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Which statement? That al-mu'minu lil-mu'mini kal-bunyan. That the believer to the other believer is like a building. Like a firmly constructed structure. Because that is what a bunyan is. A bunyan is not, you know, pieces of wood that have been stacked together and then a sheet is thrown over them. That is not bunyan. Because one push and everything will fall to the floor. What is bunyan? A firmly constructed structure. Like, for example, when bricks are layered, one on top of the other, arranged in a perfect manner. And then they're not just layered, but they're also joined together. This is how a believer is to the other, like a building. يَشُدُّ بَعْضُهُ بَعْضًا Parts of it support and strengthen other parts of it. And when the Prophet ﷺ said this, وَشَبَّكَ He interlaced بَيْنَ أَصَابِعِهِ Between his fingers. He interlaced his fingers. He brought them together to demonstrate what it means by a bunyan and what the relationship of the believers are, you know, with one another. How a believer is to another. What is it that we learn from this? Interlace your fingers and then you'll understand. Look at your fingers. What do you see? What do you see? There are no gaps. Okay. And? Now interlace your fingers and pull your hands away from each other. It's hard to do that. So when people are pulling you from different directions, but if you're united, then there is no breaking. You're together. And how is it that you're remaining firm? How? By being together. And if this interlacing of fingers is not done, then what will happen? Somebody will grab your arm from this side and your hand will go. Right? So, this is a very strong grasp. Separated fingers, they're weak on their own. But once the fingers are interlaced, they strengthen each other. So the believers are a source of strength for each other. How? That when there is a weakness in one person, who makes up for it? The other one. He will complete it. So a believer is a mirror to his brother. When you look at yourself in the mirror, what are you looking for? Defects, right? But when you identify those defects, do you just talk about them? Do you just identify them and leave them? Or do you do something about them? You do something about them. So a believer is a mirror to his brother. When he finds error in his brother, he mends him. He mends him. He does his islah. Why? Because he is in fact mending who? Himself. If his believer is in need, he aids him. When he's sick, he visits him. Because they are together. وَقَوْلِهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ And the statement of the Prophet صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ مَثَلُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ The example of the believers. فِي تَوَادِّهِمْ In their tawad. What is tawad? Mutual love. Love for one another. وَتَرَاحُمِهِمْ And their tarahum, their mutual mercy. Their mercy towards each other. Think about this. Mercy towards each other. What does it mean? Showing mercy to one another. What does it mean? Can a believer be isolated from the rest? تَوَادِّهِمْ وَتَرَاحُمِهِمْ وَتَعَاطُفِهِمْ What is ta'atuf? Mutual affection. Their empathy towards each other. Their understanding towards each other. Their feelings for one another. What is their example? كَمَثَلِ الْجَسَدِ Like the example of a body. إِذَا اشْتَكَى مِنْهُ عُضْوٌ When one part of the body complains of what? Pain, fever, injury, hurt. تَدَاعَى لَهُ سَائِرُ الْجَسَدِ The rest of the body تَدَاعَى لَهُ Complains of the same. بِالْحُمَّى With what? With fever. وَالسَّهَرُ And sleeplessness. Meaning, they share feelings and pains. When one is in need, then the other alleviates his need. They treat one another with leniency and kindness. They show concern for one another. Just think about it. If one fingernail even, is hurting. You know, sometimes you hurt your cuticle on your finger. Then what happens? Does it cause any pain? Where is that pain felt? The entire body feels it, right? Yes, the pain is extreme, you know, on one location. However, the entire body experiences the hardship. So, likewise, a group of believers, what are they? Like a body. One believer is like the finger. Another is like the arm. Another is like the eye. Another is like the head. Another is like the foot. Together. One body. So it's not possible that one is hurting and the other says, what do I care? One is suffering and the other says, oh, what a fail, what a loser. No. This is not how believers feel for each other. Each believer is performing a different role. But all believers are bound together in one body. We cannot isolate ourselves from each other. We can have differences, but we're bound together. وَيَأْمُرُونَ بِالصَّبْرِ عِنْدَ الْبَلَاءِ And they order patience. عِنْدَ الْبَلَاءِ At the times of calamity, at the times of trial. They encourage patience, not rebellion. وَالشُّكْرِ And they encourage shukr, gratitude. عِنْدَ الرَّخَاءِ At the time of rakha. What is rakha? Ease. وَالرِّضَى And they encourage al-ridha. What is ridha? Contentment. pleasure. بِمُرِّ الْقَضَاءِ بِمُرِّ الْقَضَاءِ What is mur? Bitterness. And what is qada? Decree. Meaning when decree, the qadr, it feels bitter. Why? Because it's hard. It's difficult. What do the Ahlus-Sunnah order? الرِّضَى بِمُرِّ الْقَضَاءِ They encourage patience at times of difficulty. They encourage gratitude when there is ease, not selfishness. They don't encourage selfishness. They encourage contentment, satisfaction, when at the time of difficulty, not impatience. And who do they encourage? Themselves as well as one another. وَيَدْعُونَ And they call to إِلَى مَكَارِمِ الْأَخْلَاقِ To fine conduct. This is what they invite to. They observe good conduct themselves, and they also invite to it. This is what they promote. What is makarim al-akhlaq? Makarim, you can say purest of akhlaq. Because the kareem of everything is its best. When Mu'adh bin Jabal radiallahu anhu was sent to collect zakat, he was told, beware of the kara'im of their wealth. Meaning don't take the best of what people have. So, makarim al-akhlaq is what? The best akhlaq. The finest akhlaq. وَيَدْعُونَ إِلَى مَكَارِمِ الْأَخْلَاقِ وَمَحَاسِنِ الْأَعْمَالِ And beautiful good deeds. Mahasin. What is mahasin? From husn, things that adorn you. And it refers to the actions which are upon the limbs. So what kind of actions do they encourage, do they promote? Mahasin. Beautiful, good. وَيَعْتَقِدُونَ And they believe. مَعْنَى قَوْلِهِ The meaning of his statement, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Which statement of his? That أَكْمَلُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ إِيمَانًا أَحْسَنُهُمْ خُلُقًا The أَكْمَلُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ Translate this for me. The most complete of the believers in iman. Are who? Those who are best of them in character. Those who are finest in conduct. They believe in the meaning of this hadith. And this hadith we need to remember. And this hadith we need to keep in front of our eyes. That iman is only complete with good character. Otherwise, without good character, iman is incomplete. And good character with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as well as with the creation. With Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala how? Huh? Okay, aqeedah, ibadah, receiving Allah's commands with acceptance, with submission, with openness, and with the creation, being generous towards them, and refraining from harming them. So, ahsanuhum khuluqan. وَيَنْدُبُونَ And they encourage, they invite, they urge. إِلَى towards أَن تَصِلَ مَنْ قَطَعَكَ That you join with those who cut you, who sever from you. وَتُعْطِي مَنْ حَرَمَكَ And that you give to those who forbid you. وَتَعْفُو عَمَّنْ ظَلَمَكَ And you pardon, you overlook those who wrong you. This is what they encourage. يَنْدُبُونَ Have you heard of the term mandub? What is that? Recommended. Preferred. That which is encouraged. So this is what they encourage. This is what they teach. What? First of all, أن تصل من قطعك. That those who cut off from you, you join with them. They don't say things like, don't talk to her, and don't talk to him, and don't work with her, and don't work with him. No. This is promoting what? Cutting off from each other. What do the Ahlus-Sunnah say? Talk to her. Talk to him. Call her. Work with her. Make up somehow. This is what they encourage. يَنْدُبُونَ إِلَىٰ أَن تَصِلَ مَنْ قَطَعَكَ Because what does it mean by wasl? What did the Prophet ﷺ say? Who is wasl? Who is the one who joins? The one who reciprocates? No. Who is he? The one from whom people cut off, but he joins with them. So, don't say things like, because he doesn't talk to me, I won't talk to him. She doesn't call me, I will not call her. No. أن تصل من قطعك وتعطي من حرمك The one who deprives you, you give him. So don't say things like, because she doesn't give me anything ever, I'm not going to give her anything ever. She didn't give me, I won't give her. No. What is the way of AhlusSunnah? They don't give us, we will give them. She doesn't give me, I will give her. وَتَعْفُوا عَمَّنْ ظَلَمَكَ. And that you pardon those who wrong you. What is ظُلْم? Offense and denial. Both. That when something does something offensive against you, and secondly, they also deny you your right. This is ظُلْم. Both are ظُلْم. So those who do ظُلْم on you, so for example, they do something which is not right towards you, or they take away from you what is yours, what is your right, تَعْفُوا. Pardon them. Why? In hope of Allah's mercy and forgiveness, and also in order to foster love. Because if people take your right away, and you take their right away, then what will this lead to? Fasad. If you think about it, all of the values of AhlusSunnah which are mentioned over here, what are they? Promoting Islah and keeping away from Fasad. وَيَأْمُرُونَ. And they order. They command, بِبِرِّ الْوَالِدَيْنِ. بِبِرِّ الْوَالِدَيْنِ. To be good towards parents. This is what they teach. This is what they promote. Be good towards your parents. Why? Because the ihsan of the parents are many. Out of all human beings that we know, that we live with, when it comes to personal matters, obviously when it comes to religious matters, the ihsan of the Prophet ﷺ is the greatest upon us. However, when it comes to people that we know, people whom we live with, people whom we are related to, whose ihsan is the greatest upon us? Our parents. So, وَيَأْمُرُونَ بِبِرِّ الْوَالِدَيْنِ. And what is birr with the walidain? Being righteous with the parents. To bring about good according to your ability. Do good to them according to your capacity. Whatever that you can do. And restrain from, keep away from, harming them in any way. And remember that birr al-walidain is fard ayn. And what does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala command us to do? Ihsan. وَبِرْ walidaini ihsana. So birr is the minimum requirement with the parents. And this is what the AhlusSunnah promote. Be good to your parents. And birr includes a variety of good deeds at a large scale. Different kinds. Not just one way of doing good towards parents. No, different ways. وَيَأْمُرُونَ بِبِرِّ الْوَالِدَيْنِ وَصِلَةِ الْأَرْحَامِ. And they also order this. What? To join their relationships. وَحُسْنِ الْجِوَارِ. And being a good neighbor. Why? Because whoever believes in Allah in the last day, then let him honor his neighbor. So the AhlusSunnah promote this also. That be good towards your neighbors. So much so that the Prophet ﷺ said that whenever you cook broth, he said this to a woman, that whenever you cook broth, then increase its water. Why? So that you can share some with the neighbors. So, وَصِلَةِ الْأَرْحَامِ وَحُسْنِ الْجِوَارِ. And being good towards the neighbor includes two things. Actually includes many things, but they can be summarized into two main categories. One is doing ihsan to them, honoring them, respecting them, spending on them, treating them well. And the other is refraining from harming them. Keeping away from anything that could harm them, annoy them, make their life difficult. Because you see, a neighbor, he is, you know, you can say he's helpless because he's living next to you. What can he do? He has to put up with you. You understand? So when you are living next to someone, then what is your responsibility? That you do your best to not harm them in any way. In any way. Like for example, you can have your grass cut at 7 o'clock in the morning on Sunday. But will that annoy the neighbors? Yes. It will. You could leave your grass to grow and not cut it at all. And let weeds grow. But will that harm the neighbors? It will ruin their grass. Right? You can leave the snow on your, you know, on the sidewalk, which is on your property. You could leave it, but will that annoy the neighbors? Yes. That when they have to go through your property, to walk from one side of the street to the other, they can slip because you didn't clear the snow. You could park your car in a way that is annoying them. You know, sometimes on the street, the cars are parked in such a way that people cannot go into their driveways. So this is all something that we need to take care of. حسن الجوار والإحسان إلى اليتامى. And they also order, they also encourage إحسان towards the orphans. Who is an orphan? A child that is disturbed from the loss of his father. إحسان towards that child. والمساكين. And those who are needy. Who are مساكين? Those who are disturbed. Why? Because their financial needs, I mean, are not being fulfilled. إحسان towards them. وابن السبيل. Who is the traveler? Someone who is disturbed. Why? Because he's not at home. والرفق بالمملوك. And they also order gentleness with the mamluk. Who is mamluk? The one who is owned. And who does this refer to? It refers to slaves, but not just slaves. Also, others that people own, like for example, animals. We own them, right? Whether you can call it pet or you can call it something else, whatever. Whether it's a fish or a cat or a bird. Ihsan, or gentleness towards the mamluk. Being gentle towards it. This is also something that the AhlusSunnah promote. وَيَنْهَوْنَا. And they forbid. So on the one hand, what are their values? What do they encourage? And on the other hand, what is it that they forbid people from? وَيَنْهَوْنَا عَنِ الْفَخْرِ. They forbid from fakhr. What is fakhr? To be boastful. Show off. They forbid this. Don't show off. وَالْخُيَلَاءِ. And arrogance. Thinking highly of oneself. Ostentation. وَالْبَغِي. And tyranny. Rebellion. ظُلْم. Because this is bali, right? Harming other people, rebelling against them, taking away their rights from them. So they forbid people from this. وَالْإِسْتِطَالَةِ عَلَى الْخَلْقِ بِحَقٍ أَوْ بِغَيْرِ حَقٍ. And they also forbid from istitala. What is istitala? What's the root? طول. طول, what is طول? To be tall, right? To be long. Istitala, istif'al. To try to be above people. Greater than them. Have superiority over them. But notice, wal istitalati ala al-khalq, over the creation, bihaqqin, with right. You may be justified in the fact that you are older than another person. You have more knowledge than them. You have more experience than them. You have more wealth than them. You have more status than them. You have the haqq. Still, the AhlusSunnah say, don't do istitala. Don't be haughty. Don't show yourself to be superior. Don't show yourself to be great. Don't boast over others. Don't exalt yourself over others. Don't show a sense of superiority over others. Istitalati ala al-khalqi, whether you have the right, you're justified because you have those, you know, those qualities, aw bi ghayri haqq, or even without any right. So what do they promote? Humility and respect. Humility and respect. Wa ya'muruna, and they order. Because the thing is that when someone, you know, has something because of which they are superior to others, then how do others feel around them? Insecure and threatened. And if that person is constantly highlighting, you know, their superiority over others, whether it is their age, you know, like for example, children, they're boasting, I'm older than you. You know, one child says, I'm older than you. And what do you see on the face of the other child? Poor me. Right? One child shows he has more candy. He has the haqq to show that, yes, I have more than you. He's justified in that. He's true. He's right in that. He does have more candy. He is older. But still, when he's highlighting that superiority, what is the other feeling? Bad about himself. So, even if you have certain qualities, whether it is knowledge or status or wealth, ideas, whatever it may be, don't show off. Don't talk about yourself in front of others. Don't make people feel threatened by your presence. be approachable, be welcoming. وَيَأْمُرُونَ بِمَعَالِ الْأَخْلَاقِ, and they order بِمَعَالِ الْأَخْلَاقِ, lofty characteristics. They have high standards, and that is what they encourage. وَيَنْهَوْنَ عَنْ سَفْسَافِهَا, and they prohibit base characteristics. Safsaf, what is it? Lowly, that are appalling, that are disliked, like lying, khiyana, fuhsh, that is what they forbid. These are their core values. What are their core values? What do we see in all of these words that are mentioned? Sincerity, integrity, tolerance, benevolence, dedication, discipline, respect. This is part of our aqeedah. They're not just fancy words that decorate a wall. They shouldn't just be fancy words that decorate a web page. They shouldn't be fancy words that decorate a slide. No. These are part of our aqeedah. Being sincere. An-nasiha. Integrity. Being honest and fair. Having strong moral principles. Being tolerant. Forgiving. Being benevolent. Kind. Towards parents, towards the needy, towards the orphans, towards the neighbor. Being dedicated. Unity. Discipline. Having a high standard and respect. Don't show off. Be humble. Be approachable. This is all part of our aqeedah. وَكُلُّ مَا يَقُولُونَهُ وَيَفْعَلُونَهُ, and all of this which they say and which they do. They say it and they do it. What do they say? Whatever is mentioned earlier. يَأْمُرُونَ, they order this. يَنْدُبُونَ, they recommend this. So all of this which they say, وَيَفْعَلُونَهُ, and they also do it. مِنْ هَذَا, of this, وَغَيْرِهِ, and also other than it. Meaning, this is not, you know, the complete list of their values. There's more. Because the Qur'an and Sunnah, they teach us about many more important values. So all of this, they do it. فَإِنَّمَا هُمْ, whether they teach it or they practice it, what are they doing in reality? فَإِنَّمَا, then indeed not but, whom they are, fihi, in it, مُتَّبِعُونَ لِلْكِتَابِ وَالسُنَّةِ. In reality, they are following the book and the sunnah. Why do they adopt these characteristics? Why do they promote these values? Why? Why do they prohibit certain things? What's the reason? Because they are following the Qur'an and the sunnah. Because the Qur'an tells us to adopt these noble characteristics. The sunnah tells us to adopt these noble characteristics. So they're in reality following the Qur'an and sunnah. Now many times we bring about a change in our behavior towards others. We adopt certain values. Why? What's the reason? We just want to impress other people. Or we want to be in their good books. Or we just want to improve our relationship. Or we want to be known as a person who is nice. But the AhlusSunnah do this. Why? Because they follow the book and sunnah. وَطَرِيقَتُهُمْ, and their tariqah, their way, here it is deenul Islam, the religion of Islam. And what is Islam? الَّذِي بَعَثَ اللَّهُ بِهِ مُحَمَّدًا صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ, the religion which Allah sent Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with. If you think about it, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, why was he sent? To perfect good manners. The Qur'an, what does it do? It perfects good character. It tells us what is ma'roof, what is munkar. So if we leave the Qur'an and sunnah, then where will we find good akhlaq from? Why do we have to refer to others? Why do we have to look somewhere else to find good akhlaq? Is it not mentioned in the Qur'an, in the sunnah? So all of this they do as ibadah. In other words, because you're following the Qur'an and sunnah. And this is the reason why it is said that إِنَّ عِبَادَاتِ الْغَافِلِينَ عَادَاتِ, the ibadat, the acts of worship of those who are heedless, what are they? Just mere customs. They're just adat. They're doing it without any spirit. وَعَادَاتٌ مُنْتَبِهِينَ عِبَادَاتِ, and the customs of the heedful ones, what are they? acts of worship. The habits of those who are awake, of those who are alert, of those who are conscious, what are they? Those habits are even acts of worship. Lakin, but, lamma when, akhbara an-nabiyyu sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam informed, anna ummatuhu, that indeed his ummah, sataftariqu, it will differ, it will become divided. How much? عَلَى ثَلَاثٍ وَسَبْعِينَ فِرْقَةٍ. How many groups? 73 groups. كُلُّهَا فِي النَّارِ. All of them shall be in the fire. إِلَّا وَاحِدَةٍ. Except one. And what is that one group? وَهِيَ الْجَمَاعَةِ. And it is the jama'ah. That which the people of knowledge are united upon. وَفِي حَدِيثٍ. عنه, and in a hadith from him, meaning reported from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, annahu qala, that he said, whom they are, man kana ala, those who are upon, mithli ma ana alayhi, on that which I am upon, al-yawma, today, wa ashabi, and my companions. So who are those upon guidance, despite the divisions, despite the differences, despite the many darknesses? Who are they? Those who are upon the way of the Prophet ﷺ and upon the way of the Sahaba. So since this is the case, that there are so many divisions, so many differences, the AhlusSunnah, Sara, they have become al-mutamassikuna, those who hold on to, bil-Islami, with Islam. They are the ones who hold on to Islam. Which Islam? Al-mahd. Only, meaning only Islam. Which Islam? Al-Khalis, the pure one. An-Shawb, which is free from any blemish. Whom they are, Ahl Sunnati wal Jama'ah. They are the people of Sunnah and Jama'ah. Now, over time, many things have been added to the religion. Many things have been changed. Changes have been made. But the Ahl Sunnah, what has been their way? They don't adopt those changes. What do they adopt? What do they hold on to? The pure, original faith that was practiced by the Prophet ﷺ and his companions. So the Ahlus Sunnah, what are they upon? What do they follow? How would you define them? Those who cling to the pure Islam, which is free from any distortion, free from any changes, free from any alteration. Because what does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say? An aqeemu ad-deen. وَلَا تَتَفَرَّقُوا فِي أَقِيمُ الدِّينِ. The deen which has been given, establish that. And don't differ concerning it. How will differences come? When people change the deen. When people add to it. When they innovate. Right? So, this is real unity of the Ahlus Sunnah wal Jama'ah. That they are upon the haq despite the passage of time. That over time, many things are invented, many things are changed, but they hold on to the truth. They hold on to the original. Like we learned in the hadith, that عَضُّ, bite, you know, hold on to it with what? With your molars, bin nawajid. Hold on to the original religion. This is the way of Ahlus Sunnah wal Jama'ah. Because you see, there are many people who claim to be Ahlus Sunnah. Everyone says they're Ahlus Sunnah wal Jama'ah. Right? But what is the definition of Ahlus Sunnah wal Jama'ah? Those who hold on to the Qur'an, the Sunnah, the way of the Sahaba. And this is something that we need to see. Are they holding on to the original deen? Or are they holding on to something that came later? Something that began later? So this is the way of Ahlus Sunnah. Al-mutamassikuna bil-Islam al-mahdi al-khalisi an al-shawb. Those who hold on to pure, pristine religion. Of pristine purity. Hum ahl sunnati wal jama'ati. Wa fihim as-siddiqoon. And amongst them are as-siddiqoon, the truthful. Wa shuhada'i, and the martyrs. Wa salihoon, and the righteous. Wa minhum, and among them are a'lamul huda wa masabihud duja. Among them are those who are a sign of guidance and those who are a light in darkness. Who? People of knowledge. people of knowledge. And what are they described as? A'lamul huda. A'lam is a plural of alam. And what is alam? A sign. A landmark, like for example a mountain or a flag. Sometimes certain people, certain personalities, even they're called alam. Why? Okay, so for example, they become an expert of a field, so they become a sign. You know, that science is recognized by them. Isn't it? Which is why we see that so many concepts, or so many diseases even, who are they named after? People who, you know, discovered the cure for them, or identified that disease. Correct? So, this is alam. Alam is also a personality. So, amongst the Ahlus-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah, there are A'lamul Huda. People who are a sign of guidance. Distinguished men of guidance. They are people whose directions others follow. They are people by whom others are guided. They are the nurturing scholars. Nurturing scholars. A'lamul Huda. Wa masabihu ad-duja. Masabih is a plural of misbah. What is misbah? A lamp. And ad-duja, darknesses. So those people, who are they? They're like lights. They generate light. How do people find their way? How do people find their way? Through the light that these scholars show. People tread their way under the beams of their light. Whose lights? Of the scholars. The guidance that the scholars give. Now if you think about it, when it comes to aqeedah also, so many different things, you know, people have said. So many theories. So many confusing concepts. How do you figure out what is right and what is wrong? It's literally as if a blanket of darkness has overcome the ummah. So where do you find the light? There are people in this ummah who hold on to the Qur'an and sunnah and ijma', the way of the companions. And they will be a source of light, a source of guidance. They become a landmark of guidance. Ulul manaqib al-ma'thura. And there are people who are possessors of manaqib. What is manaqib? Plural of manqiba. And it's basically a rank that a person has reached. A rank of honor. A rank of nobility. People of status. And this status, this rank, high status, this nobility that they have, it is ma'thura. Meaning it is reported. You know, generation to the next, or one person to another. Meaning their great qualities are well known. وَالْفَضَائِلِ الْمَذْكُورَةِ. And their fada'il, their virtues, they are madkura, they're mentioned. They're spoken about. So in other words, in this ummah, yes, there will be waves of darkness. There will be waves of confusion. Yes, this will happen. However, the Prophet ﷺ said that there will remain one group that is upon the haqq. And who is that one group? Those who follow the way of the Prophet ﷺ, who adopt the same way that the Prophet ﷺ was upon. They are the Ahlus-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah. And these people, there are scholars amongst them, Siddiqoon amongst them, Shuhada amongst them, Salihoon amongst them. There are scholars amongst them. And these scholars, they become a source of guidance. They become a source of light. That when people are confused, when people are in ignorance, when people are in depression, they take them out, they pull them out. And these individuals, they have great virtues, great qualities that are well known, that are established. وَفِيهِمْ. And among them are also al-abdal. Abdal. This cannot be translated. It's the plural of badal. What does badal mean? One that is changed. Abdal refers to, there you can translate abdal as substitutes. Okay, but it's not a complete translation. It refers to people of knowledge. Why are they called abdal? Because whenever any one of them dies, his substitute succeeds him. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will always, always send someone in this ummah who will be a source of guidance for the nation. Who will be a source of pulling people out of darkness. Every now and then, there will always be someone that when it will seem like the light of Islam will extinguish, and very soon people are going to forget the book of Allah, they're going to deviate from the sunnah, the Quran will be forgotten, the sunnah will become unknown, what happens? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will send someone who will be a source of badal, change, revolution. Someone who will change lives. Someone who will change the thinking of people. Someone who will change the habits of people. And do we see this in history? Yes. Do we see this in our times also? Yes. That how thousands of people, their lives are changed. Their habits are changed. Their thinking, their priorities are changed. Why? Why? Because there was someone who showed them the Quran and the Sunnah. Who put in them the love for Allah, the love for the Messenger. And because of that, a revolution began. In the life of that individual, in the family of that individual, in the community of that individual. Entire communities are changed. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sends abdal, revolutionaries, people who change lives. Because think about it, how difficult it is for people to change their lives. Is it easy? You can give them so many incentives. You can threaten them. But you cannot change them unless and until their heart is changed. So there are people from the AhlusSunnah whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives so much iman to, so much taqwa to, that they're able to touch lives. They're able to touch hearts. They're reformers. وَفِيهِمْ الْأَبْدَالِ وَفِيهِمْ أَئِمَّةُ الدِّينِ. Amongst them are the leaders in the deen. Who is imam? A model. People who will lead others. People who are a model for others. An example for others. الَّذِينَ. And there are those people who أَجْمَعَ الْمُسْلِمُونَ. The Muslims have unanimously agreed. عَلَى هِدَايَتِهِمْ. Over their guidance. وَدِرَايَتِهِمْ. And their rectitude. Meaning the Muslims have unanimously agreed that yes, these people are righteous. They are upon guidance. Like for example, you know, the author of this book, he was literally a revolutionary. There was so much chaos at his time. Not just in aqeedah, but even politically. So much unrest. So much confusion. But what happened? What did he turn people's attention to? Quran, Sunnah, Ijma'. And then after him, what happened? When he died, who became the next revolutionary? There were many, many of his students. Ibn Qayyim was one of his students. Right? So, wafihim abdal. And the Muslims have agreed that yes, these people were upon guidance. You know, even people who disagree with Ibn Taymiyyah, they will still praise him. His opponents will praise him. They will acknowledge the fact that he was a knowledgeable man. وَهُمْ. And they are الطَّائِفَةُ الْمَنْصُورَةِ. They are the group that is aided, that is helped. الَّذِينَ. Those people who قَالَ فِيهِمْ. He said about them. Who said about them? النَّبِيُّ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهُ وَسَلَّمْ. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said about them that لَا تَزَالُ طَائِفَةٌ مِنْ أُمَّتِي عَلَى الْحَقِّ. There will always remain a group of my ummah upon the truth. And this group will be mansura. They will be helped. لا يضرهم من خالفهم. The one who opposes them will not be able to harm them. ولا من خذلهم. And the one who abandons them also cannot harm them. حتى تقوم الساعة. Until the hour is established. So those upon the haqq, those upon the Qur'an, the Sunnah, the Ijma', what do we learn? They are those who are aided. They are those who are helped. But the term aid, the term help, what does that mean? What does that mean? When do you get help? When there is a problem. When you're suffering. So this, by definition, means that those who are upon the haqq will definitely experience trials and difficulties. It means that there must be aching, painful experiences of suffering. There definitely will be many trials, because only then there is a need for aid. Otherwise, there is no need for aid. There is no need for nusra. If there are no problems, why should there be help? So those who are upon the haqq, what does it mean? They will definitely be tested. They will definitely be tried. Ibn al-Qayyim said, الحق منصور وممتحن فلا تعجب فهذه سنة الرحمن. The truth is always aided. It is always tried. Then do not be surprised, because this is the sunnah of the most merciful. This is the sunnah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one who is most merciful. If you want to adopt the truth, if you want to hold on to it, then yes, there will be trials, but you will not be left alone. You will be helped. Shaykh Ibn Uthaymeen says, do not be weighed down with incapability and laziness whenever you see that you cannot achieve your target at the first try. Be patient and try once again. Be patient with the mockery and jest of people against you, because the enemies of the religion are many. Do not be disturbed by your being alone in the field. You are indeed a community, even if you are just one, as long as you are on the truth. With this, rest assured that you will be aided, either in this world or in the hereafter. إِنَّا لَنَنصُرُ رُسُلَنَا وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا فِي الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا وَيَوْمَ يَقُومُ الْأَشْهَادِ. Indeed, we will definitely help our messengers and those people who believe. Where? In this life and also on the day that the witnesses will stand. So yes, holding on to this aqeedah, holding on to this truth is beautiful, but it will also cause many trials. It will also bring many difficulties. But hold on and don't give up. Why? Because those who are upon the haqq will be helped. They will be aided. نَسْأَلُ اللَّهَ. We all ask Allah. أَنْ يَجْعَلَنَا مِنْهُمْ. That He makes us part of them. Part of who? The AhlusSunnah وَالْجَمَاعَةِ. وَأَلَّا يُزِيغَ قُلُوبَنَا. And that He does not deviate our hearts. بَعْدَ إِذْ هَدَانَا. After He guided us. وَأَنْ يَهَبَ لَنَا. And that He grants us, مِنْ لَدُنْهُ, from Himself, رَحْمَةً, mercy. إِنَّهُ هُوَ الْوَهَّابِ. Indeed, He is ever-giving. وَاللَّهُ أَعْلَمُ. And Allah is the most knowing. Allah knows best. Meaning this was our best effort, according to our knowledge and our understanding. And we ask Allah that He makes us amongst those who are upon the truth, and that He does not let our hearts deviate after He has shown us the truth, and that He grants us mercy from Himself so that we are protected from misguidance. Indeed, He is the ever-giving. وَصَلَّ اللَّهُ عَلَى مُحَمَّدٍ. And may Allah's salat be upon Muhammad, وَآلِهِ, and his family, وَصَحْبِهِ, and his companions, وَسَلَّمَ تَسْلِيمًا كَثِيرًا. And may abundant peace be upon them as well. May Allah's salat be upon His messenger. May He praise Him in the most lofty assembly, bless Him with every good, and much, much abundant peace be upon the messenger, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, his family, as well as his companions. And with this, alhamdulillah, we conclude the book with Allah's mercy, with Allah's help. And I remind you of the first lesson, in which we learned about the etiquette of learning knowledge, that first of all, a person's intention must be sincere, at the beginning as well as at the end. Once we begin this journey, this book, the study of this book, we looked at our intentions. And now also we must observe our intentions. The blessing of knowledge is a huge blessing, which demands shukr. The AhlusSunnah encourage shukr. They encourage themselves to be grateful, and they encourage one another to be grateful as well. And this knowledge is no small blessing. It demands shukr from all of us. Shukr in both ways, in all ways, from the tongue, in the heart, as well as through actions. So do something to thank Allah, to show your gratitude for the blessing of this knowledge, that you were able to begin the book and also complete it. that you were able to learn and reflect over so many ayat, so many ahadith that talk about Allah Azza wa Jalla, that talk about His Messenger, that talk about divine fate, that bring clarity to our mind, that give us motivation in our ibadah, that develop sincerity in the heart. So show gratitude. Feel grateful in the heart. Express gratitude through your tongue. And also show gratitude through your actions. Show gratitude through giving sadaqah. Show gratitude by giving sadaqah of this ilm also. Because لَإِن شَكَرْتُمْ لَأَزِيدَنَّكُمْ. If you are grateful, then surely Allah will increase the blessings for you. And at the end, we all seek forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because there have been shortcomings. There have been mistakes. There have been errors. Those errors that we realized, and those errors that we have still not realized. And may Allah pardon us for all of those mistakes. There are errors, there are shortcomings in our actions, where we say big things, but we do very little. May Allah pardon us for the ikhtilaf that definitely exists in what we write and in what we do, in what we say and in what we do. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the strength to bring all of this on one page. Our actions as well as our words. Our intentions and our actions. Anything you'd like to say, you're most welcome as to what you learned from this book or anything you'd like to express. Mansura helped, aided, and obviously that help which leads to victory. So depending on the situation, depending on the context, Nasr will be different. You know, for example, if an individual is struggling in his family and he's holding on to the haqq and there's false rumors, false propaganda that is being spread about him, what is the help? That Allah gives him strength, that the truth is made known, and that person is able to hold on to the truth. So this is help. At different levels, help is different. So in some situations, Nasr means help, aid. In other situations, it means victory. It doesn't only mean political victory. It means help and aid, which is different depending on the context. In Surah Ibrahim, where we learn about the example of the good tree, the example of the good word is like the good tree. أَصْلُهَا ثَابِتٌ وَفَرُعُهَا فِي السَّمَاءِ تُؤْتِي أُكُلَهَا كُلَّ حِينٍ بِإِذْنِ رَبِّهَا. The root is solid, it is firm, and the branches are high in the sky. And it gives fruit at all times with the permission of its Lord. This is Iman. Iman is firm, aqeedah is solid, but it's not just that. There are also branches, actions, good deeds, and then fruit. And this is exactly what we learned about in the last chapter, that these beliefs must transform into actions. And they are demonstrated through ibadah and through akhlaq, dealings with people, interaction with people. Because you see, people of Quran, who are they? Who are people of Qur'an? Who would you call people of Qur'an? Okay, those who understand it, read it, act upon it, and who spend their time with the Qur'an, right? And this is what we all desire, something because of which we will spend time with the Qur'an. Because we know exactly how we get distracted by this world and how quickly the Qur'an leaves its people. The Qur'an leaves its people. When they don't hold on to it. So we all need something because of which we can hold on to the Book of Allah. Then we will be called Ahlul Qur'an wa Sunnati wal Jama'ati. What is Jama'ah? Being together, unity. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the correct understanding of this, and may we be able to truly bring this in our lives. People of Qur'an, people of Sunnah, people of Jama'ah, people of unity. Subhanakallahumma wa bihamdik, nashhadu an la ilaha illa anta, nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk. Assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.